Here we have the sequence 1 over n. So we see that our first term, 1 over n, if n is 1, then we have 1 over 1, which is just 1. Our second term is 1 half. Then we get 1 third, 1 fourth, 1 fifth, 1 sixth, and so on. So we see that the limit as n approaches infinity of our sequence a sub n equals 0 and converges. In another example, the sequence negative 1 to the n divided by n, we get, if n is 1, we have negative 1 to the first divided by 1 is negative 1. Then we get negative 1 squared divided by 2, so that's positive 1 half. And then we get negative 1 third, positive 1 fourth, negative 1 fifth, and so on. So this is an example of where we are converging. The limit as n goes to infinity of a sub n does equal 0, but we see that we're bouncing up and down, but getting closer and closer to 0. In our next example, the sequence 2 plus negative 1 to the nth power, we start with 1, then we get 3, we get 1, then we get 3. So we see that we're bouncing back and forth between 1 and 3. And we'll keep doing this, so this means that our sequence diverges. The limit as n goes to infinity of a sub n does not exist. For the sequence n plus 1 over n, if n is 1, we get 2. If n is 2, we get 3 halves. And for n is 3, we get 4 thirds. Then we get 5 fourths. We get 6 fifths. So this one converges to 1. Our limit as n goes to infinity of a sub n equals 1. We're getting closer and closer. So for the sequence n divided by n plus 1 times cosine of n times pi, the first thing that we should notice is that this cosine term, when n is an odd number, then that means that we are getting that term is cosine of n pi equals negative 1. If n is even, then cosine of n times pi is going to be 1. So for n is 1, we get 1 half. That's going to be negative times negative 1. For n is 2, we get 2 thirds times positive 1. For n is 3, we get 3 fourths times negative 1. For n is 4, we get 4 fifths. For n is 5, we get negative 5 sixths. And for 6, we get 6 sevenths, and that's positive. So we see that we're bouncing back and forth, but we're not getting close to any number. In the one example, we were getting close and closer to 0. But in this example, we're getting further and further away from 0 with each bounce. So this means that this limit does not exist and this sequence diverges. Here we want to compute the first 5 terms in the sequence of partial sums. So if we are looking for S sub 1, then we are looking for the sum from k equals 1 to 1 of 3 times 2 to the k. So this is just one term, and it's the term where we plug in k equals 1, so we get 3 times 2 to the first, which is 6. If we want to find S sub 2, we are looking for the sum from k equals 1 to 2 of 3 times 2 to the k. So this tells us we have to first find the first term, which is 3 times 2 to the first, and add it to the second term, 3 times 2 squared. So this is 6 plus 4 times 3 is 12, So 6 plus 12 is 18. Our next term, S sub 3, is the sum from k equals 1 to 3 of 3 times 2 to the k. So we're adding the first term, which we know is 6, plus the second term, 12, to the third term, so plus 3 times 2 to the third. So this is 6 plus 12 plus 24, which gives us 42. To find S sub 4, we have the sum from k equals 1 to 4 of 3 times 2 to the k. We're adding 6 plus 12 plus 24 plus 3 times 2 to the 4th. And 3 times 2 to the 4th is 48. So we already know that our first three terms were S sub 3. So our first three terms are 42, and we're adding 48. So S sub 4 is 90. To find S sub 5, this is the sum from k equals 1 to 5 of 3 times 2 to the k. And this is going to be 6 plus 12 plus 24 plus 48, which was our S sub 4, plus that fifth term, so plus 3 times 2 to the fifth, which is 96. So 90 plus 96 is 186. So if we wanted to write down our sequence of partial sums, we'd start with S sub 1, which was 6, S sub 2 was 18, S sub 3 was 42, S sub 4 is 90, and S sub 5 is 186. And that would keep going as we found our next partial sums. So this right here is our sequence of partial sums. Here we are asked to estimate the sum of the series by computing the first several terms of the sequence of partial sums. So our series, S equals the sum from k equals 1 to infinity of 1 over the quantity 2k minus 1. So to find our first sequence of partial sums, S sub 1, we are looking for the sum from k equals 1 to 1 of 1 over 2k minus 1. So we're just looking for one term, the first term, so that's when k equals 1. So we find this is 1 over 2 minus 1, so that is just 1. To find S sub 2, we're looking for the sum from k equals 1 to 2 of the quantity 1 over 2k minus 1. We already know the first term is 1, and we need to add it to the second term. So when k is 2, we have 1 over 4 minus 1, which is 1 third. So we get 1 and a third. To find our third sequence of partial sums, we need to add up the first three terms. We know we have the first two, 1, third. Our third term is 1 over 6 minus 1, so 1 fifth. So 1 plus 1 third. So 1 plus 1 third plus 1 fifth is 23 fifteenths, which is about 1.533. S(4) is going to be sum from k equals 1 to 4 of 1 over 2k minus 1. So we have our first three terms, 1 plus 1 third plus 1 fifth, and we need to add on the fourth term, which is 1 seventh. And that gives us 176 over 105, which is about 1.676. S(5) is the sum from k equals 1 to 5 of 1 over 2k minus 1. So we have 1 plus 1 third plus 1 fifth plus 1 seventh plus, when we plug in k equals 5, we get 1 ninth, which is 563 over 315. And that is about 1.787. To find S(6), again, we have the sum from k equals 1 to 6 of 1 over 2k minus 1. So we're adding on that sixth term. So we have, this is really S(5) plus that sixth term. And when we plug in 6, we get 1 11th. So 563 over 315 plus 1 11th gives us 6,508 divided by 3,465, which is about 1.878. So it seems like we're getting really close to 2. And if we graph this, these green dots right here, this is our sequence of partial sums, these green ones. So we thought that this series converged to 2, but when we graph several terms, we actually find out that it bypasses 2 and it keeps getting bigger and bigger, so it diverges very slowly. And we'll prove this later on. But for now, this is an example of why it's not good enough just to plug in numbers. We actually need these rigorous proofs to show that even though the terms that we're adding on are getting smaller and smaller, we're still adding on enough so our sequence of partial sums diverges.